So let's start again. Yes, yeah, so now I come to something that was already what is still on the whiteboard. But then I will continue right from here. So this happens that a root is even on X, the coroot evaluates to even numbers on X. It happens only in a reducible case for what we call type CN, so affine type C. So the diagram that belongs to that is like so, and so then your S and S prime will be these extreme ends. But you see also that indeed you have three conjugacy classes if you look at this diagram. And just one would perhaps like to ignore this because it's so annoying to bring it along all the time, but miraculously this happens to be some sort of the key case for all classical groups. So different choices of the three parameters you have sort of cover all the types for the unipotent types for classical groups. So this is a very important phenomenon, this freedom. And then let me make another remark here, that so there is a based root datum which we distill from what
I don't understand the statement. I mean, you say in other cases you have the same parameter.
So the phenomenon that alpha and alpha plus one are not conjugate in the affine Weyl group, if the affine Weyl group is irreducible, it's only this case. So that's the only irreducible case where you have three parameters. And so we attach a based root datum. So remember what we did. So we have this lattice X, which is canonical. We chose a special point in the alcove. And then we fix a based root datum, delta 0 X, delta 0 check Y. So the delta 0 corresponds to S 0. And for the roots in and this is really determined. So because the affine root system is determined by the diagram, by the affine diagram. So we know also what the roots are that we should choose in this associated to the special point that we chose. So a root in delta zero, we attach two parameters, namely V alpha plus, which is the square root of Vs, Vs prime. And of course here S is S alpha check. And V alpha minus, which is the square root of Vs over Vs prime. And so this is one if this alpha check is not twice a co-weight. So formally, at this point, in order to be able to do this, we need to extend the base ring by adjoining these square roots vs vs prime. We will do this, so I will not further dwell on that, but that's unfortunate. Maybe so let me continue here.
Can you move it up just a bit?
Excuse me?
Can you move it up just a bit, the last line?
So now the center can be described in this presentation very beautifully and famously. So it is in the Laurent polynomial ring on the theta x, just the Weyl group invariants. But remember that it all depends on this special point that we chose, right? So this abelian subalgebra depends in the Hecke algebra on the choice of this special point. But the center, of course, does not. And so this is the regular functions on a torus. Is the algebraic torus with character over C with character letters X, and we view this as a torus over lambda. Sorry, so it is not X, but it is extended. Namely, we take Z, S mod Weyl group conjugacy times X. Oh my gosh. I don't want to think about that now, but I will. And so I view it as a torus over lambda via, so Vs to the n I send to n times Es 0 in this decomposition of the letters. But that gives me a structure as a lambda variety. Okay, so now section 4, intertwining elements. Mu function and the formula for the trace. Formula for trace. So in the Bernstein presentation, we are looking for the alternative formulation of the trace in those data. So it turns out that it is crucial to reformulate the Bernstein exchange relation using the following elements. So S is S alpha. Then I define an element RS as follows: VS 1 minus theta minus 2 alpha ns minus vs 1 over vs plus vs prime minus 1 over vs prime theta minus alpha. Yeah, that's it. And then these satisfy the following relations. So this is an element of H. These elements satisfy, well, if you square them, you get Vs squared delta 2 alpha delta minus 2 alpha C alpha C minus alpha, where delta minus 2 alpha is just 1 minus theta minus 2 alpha, and C alpha, maybe now I can go to here. C alpha is 1 plus theta minus alpha over Q alpha minus. So if I write a Q, it's always the square of the corresponding V. So Q alpha minus is this V alpha minus squared. And 1 minus theta minus alpha Q alpha plus, divided by delta minus 2 alpha. And moreover, they satisfy the Braid relations, very importantly. So, as a corollary, if you invert the appropriate elements of the form, well, the factors that you see here in the center, then the Hecke algebra becomes very simple. It becomes just a twisted group ring over these Laurent polynomials on the torus of the Weyl group, right? So corollary, so if we do a localization, and I don't want to specify exactly what, but you should invert the appropriate elements, then this turns out to be simply, the smash product of the theta x localized smash product the finite Weyl group. So that takes away all the subtleties in some sense of the affine Hecke algebra. Now define the mu function, and that is related intimately to these squares of these intertwining elements. So mu of t is this constant d that I'm dragging along, which is in the normalization of the trace, divided by the q of the longest Weyl group element in W0, 1 over the product sigma 0 plus C alpha T C minus alpha T. So I can also write this maybe as D over Q W0, and then 1 over CT CT inverse, where C is the product over the positive roots of all these factors C, which I specified here. And so these I now view as functions on the torus. The alphas are the corresponding characters. So here I view So that is the interpretation. And now there is a role for this mu function in the spectral theory that is explained by some formal series. So theory. So let T be an element in our torus, just working over C now. So I fix V alpha plus minus positive and consider curly ET is the sum over the lattice T minus X theta. So this is just the character pairing between, well, the X's are characters on the torus, so this is the natural pairing. So this is the same as X of T. And then what is in this sum? Let me see. Just theta x. And so I can, this is of course a formal element only, because you take an infinite sum over the base. But it turns out that it converges weakly in the dual of the affine Hecke algebra. But you need a condition for this. So it is weakly convergent in H star if the real part of alpha t is less than V S inverse for all simple roots in finite simple roots. And moreover, you can compute this thing rather precisely. It has the following form. It's some matrix coefficient of a principal series divided by QW0 delta T times the mu function. And here, T goes to ET, is a functional on the Hecke algebra, is regular. Regular family of matrix coefficients of principal series representations at T, such that, well, the following properties hold. If you evaluate this thing at the unit element of the Hecke algebra, you get QW0 times delta T. So that's the Weyl denominator. That's the product of all these delta minus two alphas. And if you take any element and you multiply on the left and the right by something from the commuting subalgebra A, so the A and the B here are in this commutative subalgebra, then you get left and right, it has eigenvalue T. Yes? Which aspect are you talking about?
Is
say you have this infinite sum.
Yes.
But what do you mean by it's an element of H star?
Well, in the sense that is written here below. So the point is.
But how do you define it as a linear function on H?
Yeah, you can identify it by the trace, indeed. And so what you want to show is that if you expand these Bernstein elements, of course, for X dominant, they are just basis elements in the Coxeter presentation. But if you take this X not dominant, you need to re-express it in terms of the Coxeter basis. And then you get more and more complicated expressions. And what you want to see is that if you have this condition, that all these coefficients of the individual Coxeter basis elements are convergent. And this is a very strong convergence, so it doesn't matter on the...
Where do you say Coxeter basis?
So we have the NW basis, in which the trace is very simple. Okay, so that's the result, and as an immediate consequence, because this is just a Fourier series, abelian Fourier series. So now we can write the trace with the same interpretation as Martin is mentioning. Corollary, the trace is equal to the integral. Well, you have to be in the domain of convergence, so that means that I integrate over t0 and then the unitary part of the torus with some fixed parameters, and I take the real part of this. Well, this t0 should be very small in this sense, so if you evaluate the roots, the simple roots, you get less than this, and then you take this kernel et. So I can put an h here. I want divided by qw0 delta t times this mu of t dt. And so that's the formula for the trace in the Bernstein structure. And now we do what is called residue calculus. So that is some yoga, how to compute such kind of integrals with or rational N0 forms like this on a torus. And I'm not going to say much about this, but as a result, so this is residue calculus, but I will just come to some corollaries of that, and I will not go into the technical details. So then I can rewrite this as follows. So it is equal to an integral over t check temp. V temp chi t d nu t, and here nu is the Plancherel measure of the trace restricted to the center. So that's a positive measure. For each t in this support, chi t is a tempered positive trace with central character belonging to that element, and t nu temp is a union over what is called residual cosets for the mu function. of the tempered part of this residual coset, where L in TV is called a coset. A coset of a subtorus. In short, I will just say a coset is called residual well, if it has enough poles with respect to this mu function. So here is the condition. If the number of mu poles, pole hyperplanes, alpha is equal to q alpha plus minus, which contain L, minus the number of mu zeros containing L, counted in the same way. So this mu function, as you can see, these C functions, they have in the numerator, the reciprocals of these C functions, in the numerators they have these wild denominator factors, so you can have zeros at the reflection hyperplanes, and they have poles at these shifted versions of those by the q's. And so in this way you count for a given coset of a subtorus, how many poles do you have and how many zeros. And if that difference is at least the codimension, then you call it residual. And okay. So for such an L in T, residual coset, we can write sigma L is the constant roots on it, so this is the corresponding Levy. T sub L is the subtorus corresponding to the subspace that they span. T upper L is the perpendicular of that, so that's the identity component of the intersection of the kernel of all these roots. And RL is the intersection, so I'm if I think about just here is the unit element, so I have L is an affine subspace, so here I have T lower L, here I have some intersection point which I call RL, and then I can write L is RL T upper L. And so this is the torus T upper L. And the intersection of these two tori is a finite abelian group, which you all the time have to bring along because it plays a role in everything. So there is KL is TL, the upper L. So RL is unique up to elements of this K lower L. But that's not a big deal. We just choose one. Okay. And one important thing about this residue calculus is that it tells you the following. This algebraic condition, namely the number of poles minus the number of zeros is at least the codimension, is sufficient to know that it is in the support of the Plancherel decomposition. So that's the support theory. So so the support of nu is exactly equal to these tempered forms. The tempered form I didn't explain. So L temp is now you take RL times the unitary part of the torus. And that's okay because this is a finite group, so this choice doesn't influence it. So now I take the union of all these tempered forms, and that's the support of your measure. And for all t in this support, the chi t that I wrote somewhere there, left high on the blackboard, is almost everywhere a positive trace on the Hecke algebra. And if L is only a point, is a residual point, they correspond to the discrete series, then chi r is a finite positive sum. Let me just finish this sentence of discrete series characters with central character. Yes?
Yes, so where is t and where is t check?
No, the check is here.
L coset and t or t check?
That, yeah, it's very unfortunate. I mean a V.
Oh, that's a V.
Yeah, it means I specify the parameters V to positive numbers. But I agree. Yeah, I don't know. It's always chasing me, these accidents. Okay, and so it's a finite positive sum of discrete series characters with that central character. And in fact, you can say much more about the structure. That is based on that is parabolic induction, but you can study that very well by looking at the structure of the formal completion of a Hecke algebra at a central character using Lustig's analysis of that. And then one can see that, so this is parabolic induction, that if L is RL, T upper L is residual, such that sigma L is a standard parabolic, let T be in L tempered, then we have the induced representation so with the parabolic standard parabolic subsystem of roots I get a Levy subalgebra H upper L. So just you omit all the simple reflections from your Hecke algebra, which are not in this in the simple system corresponding to this. And that has a semi-simple quotient. And in that quotient you can choose a character, T upper L, which is in this torus of characters which are perpendicular to the Levy roots. So that is the homomorphism phi T, and this is a subalgebra. So we have this subquotient here, which is semi-simple again. And there we have a discrete series corresponding to this residual point, RL. So, which occurs in this chi T, in the case when you have a residual point. Then what you can say is about the structure of chi T in general. Maybe it fits here. The order of the Weyl group times the character of at T is equal to the induced the character of the induced representation from H upper L to H, and now we take the trace for this semi-simple Hecke algebra at RL, compose it with this, so we lift it using this homomorphism to HL, and then we induce. Now already I said there, but I want to say it again because I want to make a remark about it. So this trace can be decomposed as a sum delta discrete series central character of delta WLRL D HL delta times the character of delta with the H R positive numbers. And the nu, the measure nu on the center, turns out to be a sum over all these L's of measures nu L. So this is nu L supported on L temp. And so this I write as mu upper L T dt. And in fact, this turns out to be just a regularization of mu along this set of poles. Along, I will make it more precise, but this is the idea. So precisely mu L T is a constant in Q plus, and then mu sigma L R L evaluated at R L M L dtl. So this t was equal to rl t upper l. And so this part is d over q longest Weyl group in the Levy product prime alpha sigma l 1 plus alpha RL inverse 1 minus alpha inverse divided by 1 plus alpha inverse RL over Q alpha plus 1 minus alpha inverse RL Q alpha minus absolute value. And so this expression I call M sigma L R at V. So this is a rational function in V in this parameter space associated to sigma L complexified and it is in fact regular on this real locus that we identified where all the parameters are positive real numbers. And so this function is very important. This is a regular rational function of the parameters. And it determines, if you vary the parameters, exactly when this point RL stays a residual point. So the zeros of this function will show exactly for which parameters these things stop to be residual. And it's very interesting to follow those points in that sense. So this is about the Plancherel mass, basically, of the discrete series for the Levy. And this part is just very simple. This is just the remaining roots which are not in L, and then the C functions of those. So product alpha in sigma plus L, the roots not in sigma lower L, 1 over C alpha t inverse. So this gives you essentially the Plancherel density. This is what depends on t. And what is very important property of the decomposition I gave here of this trace in terms of discrete series characters is that these constants, we will later see they are rational numbers. But for now, what is already important to know is that if you scale the parameters, they don't change. V, so V epsilon. S is just Vs to the epsilon, where epsilon is just any positive number. So, or I can take any integer even. So that means that this scaling leaves these constants really constant, which is important when you are thinking about Q dependence as rational functions of these formal degrees, right? Because it tells you that in that sense, in this is the direction in which the Q of the base change varies, the dependence is only given by this function, not by these constants. But later we will see, next time in fact, that these constants are actually rational numbers over the full parameter space, even if you have intermediate places where this thing stops to be residual point. Okay, thank you.